ga je niet meer bij de stoel zien. Volle bak. Welkom iedereen bij deze presentatie Level Up Your Test Strategy. Mijn naam is Randy Semeleer. Ik ben vandaag zaalmoderator van deze zaal. Een bescheiden rol na al die mooie sprekers die hier bij het podium komen. Even een paar huishoudelijke mededelingen. De vragen, als u die eventueel heeft, die kunnen bewaard worden tot het einde. En ja, als u een vraag heeft, dan zal ik hem nog even herhalen, zodat de mensen die thuis zijn... Hallo. Zodat de mensen die thuis zijn het ook nog kunnen horen, omdat jullie niet allemaal een microfoon hebben natuurlijk. Ook welkom voor de mensen die online meekijken natuurlijk. De mensen die online meekijken, die kunnen de chatplatform gebruiken om vragen te stellen. En ja, mocht u het liever via de chat-app doen, dan kunt u het in de zaal ook nog de chat-app gebruiken om een vraag te stellen. Dan ja, zal ik dat in de gaten houden en dan maken we daar wat tijd voor. De spreker vandaag is Bart van Parijs. En ja, we zijn heel blij dat hij wat tijd wilde maken om bij te dragen aan de QX Day. Heb ik het over de vraag gehad, over de chat-app. En het is sinds ja, dit jaar ook mogelijk om te gaan raten. Dus je kunt een rating of feedback achterlaten over de presentatie. En ja, daar kan de organisatie en de spreker natuurlijk weer zijn voordeel mee doen. Dus doe dat vooral. Heb ik dan alles gehad? Volgens mij wel. Doe ik alleen hetzelfde als net. Begin ik in het Nederlands en het
oh, ja.
Engels. Ja, yeah. Yeah, sorry about that. Any non-Dutch speakers over here? Okay, okay. No worries for the people at home also. The talk today is Level Up Your Test Strategy. And the speaker is Bart van Parijs. So we're very pleased that he will be joining us here for this talk. Questions, please save them for at the end. And you can use the chat app. When you're online, also in the house, you can use the chat app. If you want to say them, you can just raise your hand at the end and ask your question. I'll repeat it for the people at home because we're not all mic'd. It's also possible to rate the presentation at the end or give feedback. So please feel free to do that. And without further ado, Bart van Parijs, ladies and gentlemen.
It's nice to get the applause in the beginning. Hey, Level Up Your Test Strategy. I saw the title of this event, Level Up, and my first thought was, this is going to be about games. And I found out that we were actually the only one who were going to talk about games, but still, today, about gamification and testing. So let's start this presentation. Well, to start, it's a game, the audience in the room here already. You get 100 points to start with, the people at home get 50 points. Don't worry, you'll be able to catch up very quickly. Let's give some points as well for the interesting question and the insights that you can share, be it on the chat or from the room at the end of the presentation, of course. So I'm Bart. I'll be your game master for today. As you see two pictures here. I'm not schizophrenic. We actually prepared this presentation, the both of us. Steve Desmet is a close colleague of mine. Steve has recently leveled up his personal life. He became the father of a beautiful daughter, so he could not be here today, but I guess he's online. Hey, Steve. But Steve actually wrote the original blog post on the Sogeti Labs site, which led to this topic, and we then investigate and explore it further to make it into this talk. Now, I've been in testing, I've been in IT for give and take 20 years. And most of that I've been in digital assurance and testing. So I'm very happy today to be amongst fellow enthusiastics about testing. I guess I don't have to explain to any of you about the value of testing, about why testing is such a good investment, about how it contributes to the success of any organization. I'm seeing a lot of nodding. Yes, we're all convinced of that. Now, if you would want, I can talk to you about that, about why testing is so necessary and so valuable. And one of the reasons that I can do that is actually because I have to do that quite a lot. I'm not always in such a friendly audience. I'm often talking with lots of teams, working with lots of teams who have other priorities. Look, we are testing professionals. That's what we do. We know that testing is a must. We know it's valuable. So we are the guys and the girls who make this happen. Of course, there's so much work, you can't do testing on your own. So you have to talk to the team. And you will work to them, and you'll explain, what you need. Because, well, there is environments, there's data, there's configuration, there's information, there's a lot that you need to get that testing done. But you know how it goes. Things get in the way. And then all of a sudden, you look behind you, over your shoulder, and you ask, hey, where is that team? I thought I convinced them. I thought that they understood what we needed. And now they're off doing something else. Look, I don't blame them. The teams that we worked with, they're very busy. They're imagining new solutions. They're being creative. They're doing what we do. They're creating this digital future. They're imagining. They're designing. They're being on a drawing board. Yeah, they're building. They're putting things in operations. They are operating them. So then things tend to get in the way. They know, when we explain them, they will know, yes, part, yes, of course, testing is important. I see what you need, and yes, we need to get it done, but hey, there's something else interesting here that seems to be of more importance today, so let's get that done. Now, that is something universal. From the day of the first man who lived in the cage, okay, in the cave, at all times in the prehistoric times, people had already to-do lists. I'm very amazed that in that cave that their first drawing was of an animal, I thought it would have been a to-do list. Okay, there's always something to do. I have to hunt, but I have to draw, I have to find stones to carve, and it's the same thing today. There's a lot of things that are fighting for our focus, for our attention, for our time, our energy. And that's the same thing for ourselves. I know that there's a lot of things that I should be doing that I'm not necessarily doing. Okay? Now, as long as people have been around, we've been fighting with that. How do we get to do things that we know should be done? And it's actually a very nice way and a very successful way to do that, and that's by turning it into a game. As I mentioned, Steve wrote a blog post about that before the summer. It's about gamification. Now, we have not invented gamification. And people have been thinking and have been experimenting already about how can we put gamification to use to get our testing done. Now, I'm working at my desk a lot of the time, especially the last year and a half, where I'm working from home, which means that I'm sitting a lot on my chair. And I know that exercise is good for me. I need to exercise. I need to go running, I need to go swimming, I need to do a lot of things. To-do list. And you know, there's a lot of other things that are on my to-do list. And often, the most pressing thing is to sit in my comfy chair with a lot of Netflix series that I still want to watch. Especially as it's doing now, it's raining, it's cold outside, so that to put on my running shoes, my gear, and to go out there, it's a hurdle that I have to get past. Enter Strava. Does everybody know Strava? Hands up, who knows Strava? Oof. That's already, I don't have to explain all of it. So what Strava is doing, it's an app that you can put in your phone, on your smartwatch or whatever, and you can start tracking. And if you saw the keynote speaker of today, you're already convinced that all of that data is fantastic because it can help you train a lot better. It's giving you insights, and then you can do better. Now, Strava is not only being used by professional sporters. How comes? Well, it's actually because there's something really very strong in Strava, which is, it's turning my personal exercise, is that thing that I'm doing in the dark in the fields that nobody's seeing, it's making it public. Okay, I can put a picture on it. I can put a nice title on it. And it's becoming visible to my friends, to my network. And there's something very nice, and that's, I'm glad you started with an applause, because applause is very motivating. You see there, people can give me applause for my exercise. They give me kudos. Okay, that's nice. It is motivating. Now, Strava is also entering some competition. Not only am I competing with others, I'm also competing with myself. It's showing me my personal records on very silly pieces of my walk. And then it shows that there was somebody else who beat me to it. Well, now I'm already a bit more motivated to go out. And when I'm out there, I'm motivated to do you even better. Right? Now, we can even take that a step further. And right now, I'm with Capgemini Sogeti Belgium. We're doing a kind of a competition between our different practices, because we know that exercise is healthy, and we want people to get out there. So we formed teams. Okay, and I'm in a team. I'm in a digital assurance and testing practice. Okay, and now I can see myself where I'm in the team. And even more, now we start competing between practices. Digital Assurance and Testing Belgium was this weekend. We were in second place, right? So it'll be a bit late when I come home this evening, but still I wonder if I should not go out and run, take one for the team. Because now if I don't go running, I don't just feel bad for myself. I'm feeling like I'm letting my team down a bit. You see, all of this pressure is building up. It's motivating me to actually do this stuff. I know that I should. But instead of sitting in my comfy chair and watching yet another Netflix series, I'm going to go out there and practice. Good for me. Okay. So, this is what we call gamification. It's we're turning something which is not necessarily a game, we're adding a playful element to it, we're adding some competition to it, okay, especially to engage, to pull people in. So we do that because we have some targets, we want to motivate people towards something, right? And then we're going to challenge, and we're going to celebrate achievement. Remember those kudos and that applause, right? So gamification, and a very nice example that I read was about this apartment building in New York, I think it was, and it had a challenge, a big apartment building, hundreds of people living in there, and all those people have to pay their rent in time, and they have to be insured, and all of those things. Well, they actually turned into a game. If you paid your insurance in time, 50 points extra. If you paid your rent in time, 12 points extra. If you did it 6 months in a row, an extra 100 points. And then they put it at the entrance level. It's just a playful element to something which is, in essence, very dull to do. Right? Gamification. So we're making it more playful to engage people. Everybody with me so far? Good. We can go to the next level. So I talked to you, we had this conversation, me and Steve, about gamification and testing. What's in there? Well, let's look at five reasons why gamification would be an ideal thing for testing. Now to start with, and I know I'm preaching to the choir here, eh? You know this, of course. Look, testing sometimes has this reputation of being something very repetitive, mind-numbing activity of just pressing some buttons over and over again. And now I see you nodding. No, Bart, that's not it. I know. We are testing very complex solutions that require all of the creativity, all of the critical thinking, all of the focus. It requires people to be engaged, because we want them to challenge our solutions. Real testing is deep thinking about what is the solution, how would it behave, how would it go bad, how can we put it to the test? So when we want to engage people to do testing, I don't want to say, well, please do this testing because you have to, okay? If I say that I have to, or even if I put testing tasks in their Kanban board or in their task list, the best I will get is indeed some repetitive, non-inspired testing. That's not what I want. What we want is real testing. Creative, critical thinking, engaged. And we don't only need that of some specialized testers. We're working in an agile DevOps world. We need to have that done by the entire team. I'm working not with one team. I'm working with 5, 10 different, 15 different teams that all of them need to take testing very seriously. Right? So I said, I don't want to have them testing done because Bart says so. I don't want to have them testing done because it's a chore that they need to do. I actually want them to do testing because they want to. Because I know only when they really want to, then only will they be really engaged and will have their focus. Now, I'm talking about not just those couple of test analysts. We need to have the entire team. For a lot of our solutions, they are so complex that we actually need a lot more. We need to involve a very large audience. Because what we are testing, these applications, these solutions, well, we actually need real users. We need these things to be tested in the field with a lot of variety, in configurations, in real-world circumstances. Now, this is not new. Gaming industry and a lot of others have already practiced this an awful lot, okay, with beta releases and so on. The thing is, it's not because it's there. I can create a new solution, I can put it out there and say, ha, I need beta testers, who wants to test my solution? I need people to put their time, energy, and focus in that, so we'll have to draw them in. Now, if I draw them in, it's not without a danger. Because by definition, I'm putting something to the test that is not perfect yet. If it would be perfect, if I would be convinced that it's fantastic and it does what it needs to do, then I would not need to have it tested. So if I put out something there that is not yet perfect, I have a risk if I show it to an audience that they will look at this and say, well, this is not a good application, it's not a good solution. I'm not going to use this. This is buggy. This is flaky. Okay. What I actually want is when I engage them, I want them to feel as well that they are collaborating to the solution. They're actually making it better. And a very nice example of this is the Microsoft Insider program. Microsoft is actually engaging a very large audience already to improve their own products, and the people that are in there don't actually feel like that. They feel like I can contribute, I'm collaborating. Once that this is out there, I'm one of the first to see it, and I get to improve it. And my suggestions will be taken into account. It is creating some ownership. Good, I still have you with me. We've gained another 5 points. Who feels good with those 5 points? I do. Do you feel it, those points? Ah, isn't this rewarding? So, our 5 points. We need people's creativity and focus. We really want to have them engaged, and we need the whole team to have that because we want them to do testing. They need to be motivated. We need more and diverse testing, and we want to create some buy-in as well. Right, we go to the next level. We have a challenge unlocked. Let's gamify our testing. Because obviously, I'm not just going to create an appetite that you say, yes, that would be a nice idea, gamify testing. I will go home and think about it, how I can get that done. So let's give you some thoughts on how to actually do that. Well, to start with, if we look at the game, well, a game is something very boring, isn't it? There are 4, 5, 6 buttons, up, down, left, right, and then some other buttons. In essence, that is a very boring thing. What makes it nice and what makes it engaging is the story that you tell around it. Now, when we do testing, we're actually also in a story. We are going in an adventure. There is a risk. There is something that is threatening the success of our organization. If there wouldn't be, then why are we building this solution? Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to conquer the hidden defects, the hidden issues in our solution. And to do that, we will have a number of people who will have to play a role in that. We'll have some knights that are going to conquer the dragon. They are going to fight this solution. We'll have some others who contribute, who are going to gather the resources to make this happen. Right? Because we have some challenges. We'll have to have our environments and so on. And in the end, that's what's nice about the game. There is somewhere a point where we have won the battle, where we have achieved our goal. Now, with testing, we can do that as well. And I really encourage you to do so. When we're doing testing, I know that everybody knows about risk-based testing. That's where we start. We know that the solution that we're building, and imagine that we're building an e-commerce solution. Well, of course, there is a risk that when we put this in production, that there's an error in the processing of the orders. And when that happens, the phones of our client support are going to be red hot. That's a risk. That's us. That's testers who are going to protect our organization from that. There's actually a financial risk. If the price information in our e-commerce site is wrong, then our CFO will be very unhappy with the losses that have occurred. If our application is not responsive, then we will lose a lot of revenue. That's not nothing. It's always very nice to do a testing presentation a day after one of the major players in the field was down for 6 hours, okay, even if it's an infrastructure thing, but it shows that, well, we're a bit the guardians of our organizations. We're protecting them from harm. That's a storyline that you can use to engage and motivate people in testing. And then there are a number of hurdles that we will have to pass, be it test environments, be it test data, and so on. A lot of the presentations today will be about passing those hurdles. And that is a storyline that you can bring to your teams so that they see, where are we heading? What are the challenges ahead of us? Okay. Now, next thing that we can do, and we've taken an example which was posted by one of the co-hosts of this event, Puck. Bring your testing into reality. Let's make it shown. That bug jar is a very nice thing. It is a playful element. Each time that there's a bug, we put one in or out of the jar. What we're doing is, it's becoming visible. In our room where we're working, that's our bug jar. It's making it visual. Then, a wall of fame, okay? Remember the applause about the Strava app, making it visual, making it known. Now, what I'm showing here, I hope that is not new to a lot of you. We have testing tools, and we are working with lots of dashboards and information. Let's tell a story about them. This one to the right, okay, a kind of risk coverage status board that shows where are we. In every game, you will have this scoring board. Well, the same thing for us. Now, in Strava, I'm visualizing my achievements and that of my team. But we can do that as well for testing. If there is a very cool issue found, and what is a cool issue? And this is one that is found by David. David has found that if two users are doing something concurrently, then there is a behavior that we had not anticipated at all. This is something which is cool. David has thought about what are the risks and how can we simulate this in our environment, and he has found something that perhaps would have been difficult to find just on paper. David actually used his imagination. We want to have more people to act like David. Now, if you want that, well, then let's visualize it. Let's celebrate it. Okay? And then we can put it, and we can put the kudos, and you see with the likes and such, likes are very powerful. I think that by now everybody knows that. So let's use that to reward and to stimulate the behavior that we want. One of my favorites, and this is really where you can turn it into a game, is the bug hunt. Has anybody ever done a bug hunt? Okay, some have done it. You liked it?
I organized it.
Okay, now bug hunts are really very nice because you can really then all these things that we have talked about, I've talked about the adventure, about the storyline, about bringing it to life. You can do that because you're bringing together everybody in one room. How does it work? You organize that at least you can have the team or a part of the team together for, let's say, an hour and a half, 2 hours. And you're first going to explain the purpose. And the purpose is, of course, to protect us from the risks. We're going to set the stage. And now we're going to brainstorm. What are our ideas? How could we be testing that? How could we actually challenge our application? And we're going to do it. And we're going to see, ah, fantastic, David is doing something fantastic. And we're going to shout it out to the team to inspire the others as well. It's a very focused session that you do. It's exploratory testing but with a group. And then at the end, you have your points. You have the number of bugs. It's something which you can celebrate. Okay. Now, one point where I want to be a bit careful about is the competitive element. Of course, you could create a dashboard about who has created the most test scenarios, who has executed the most test scenarios. There's obviously a danger to it, because people will start doing test scenarios just for the sake of it. Okay, and it's not necessarily because you have done a lot of test scenarios that you have reached a lot of coverage. So I like these things to the right a lot better. Our test coverage hero, who has contributed the most to how confident we are about our solution. The bug bounty hunter, who has found the most interesting bug, even not the biggest number of bugs, but the most interesting ones with the highest criticality. Okay. Our automation wizard. These type of badges of celebration, they really work to motivate your team. And then the last one, and I know I'm preaching to the choir, testing is a fantastic part of IT. It is rewarding, it is creative, it is intellectually stimulating. But to convince others, sometimes we have to make it a privilege, especially if you need to engage a larger group in testing. Then you can use things like the early access, exclusive content, and you can actually work with rewards. Now, rewards, that can be anything. It can be gift cards, it can be vouchers, it can be anything. And a lot of organizations have already been working with this because they know that, well, they need the audience engaged, and an interesting defect that is found during this testing will save them a lot of money. So, for instance, this type of bug bounties. Also, insecurity, okay? This is a really known practice. And the rewards can even be very high, to €1 million dollars for people who find really very critical security vulnerabilities. So these are things that are actually done, and you can use them as well. And it can, in the end, save you a lot of effort and time and money, of course. Gamification testing. We've gone through some levels. Just to give you one last bonus level, I've already mentioned it a bit. We have to be careful about it. It's not about rewarding behavior and testing that we don't want. We should use it really to engage, to inspire people to get to the testing that is really contributing to our success, the really valuable testing. That's what I wanted to share with you about gamification and testing. Really looking forward to your insights, questions, if there are any. And Steve had put in this one, I really want to show it. That's cool, no? Do we have any questions from online?
Thank you, Bart. Yes, we have a bunch of questions from online, but are there any questions in the house before I go to the people at home? Okay, let's go to online then. From Akshaya, I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, apologies otherwise. How do we standardize creativity and create acceptance?
How do we standardize creativity?
Yeah, it's an interesting question, but it kind of sounds like a contradiction.
Yeah, it sounds like a contradiction. On the other hand, I would hope that in our sector that creativity is standard. Okay, so you can't standardize creativity, but you can standardize that in at fixed moments that you foresee room for creativity. That's, for instance, why I like this idea of a bug hunt. It's creating some time in your overly busy schedule to be creative. And you know, to be really creative, you need time, you need to have some space. And I think that is something that we as testing professionals can create for our teams. So I hope that answers the question.
Thank you.
We have one in the room here. The most interesting bug hunt that I have done...
Bart, can you repeat the question for the people?
Sorry. So the question was, if we have in a very early stage, and we know that application is buggy, okay, we will have so much bugs, is it even interesting to do a bug hunt? Well, yes. The most interesting bug hunt that I ever did was for an application that had not been built yet. It wasn't there. It was really a creative activity. We started thinking, and that's where the facilitation role is so important. We're not interested in those little layout problems or those little defects. What we're interested in is those really big errors that are going to make our application unusable or are going to create a huge impact. And that's a nice thing. If you can get people around a whiteboard where you even draw your application, and you have that creativity and a creative thinking, what could go wrong? Right? What would be the interesting defects? And then you actually give that to your team. And you now build something that will not have those defects. So I understand indeed if it's still very early, but that's a facilitation. You want that bug hunt to go to the really interesting stuff. Yeah.
Okay, so I'm sorry, Bart, we're out of time. We had a bunch of interesting questions in the chat also. So Bart, I will ask you, will you log on and
sure thing.
The platform and answer the questions for the people at home? For the people here, if you have a question, I'm sure you can catch Bart downstairs at the bar or online otherwise. Bart, thanks so much for your insights. A few things I want to remind people of. Again, you can rate the talk and you can give feedback on it for both Société as an organizer and as Bart as a speaker. So please do that. If you want to talk about the event online, you can use hashtag QXDay 2021. And a little bit about the next sessions in this space right here. If you want to follow that in 15 minutes, there's a talk, Why No Code Does Not Equal Simple and Might Be the Answer to Scalable Automation. Downstairs in the Perserij, Accelerating Testing and Development with Machine Learning. Sounds also interesting. And then on this floor, there is a talk a little bit over there. Quality engineering, kennis en vaardigheden ontwikkelen, ervaring van experts. Dat is in het douchelokaal. I guess that's a Dutch talk. Test tooling inzetten bij een complexe DWH in de postkamer. Also on this floor, also sounds like a Dutch talk. And there is a deep dive workshop, test automation and metrics. Op zoek naar waarde in de havenmeesterzaal, also on this floor, on the end of the hall. So for the people online, of course, you can click to the talk of your choice. And everybody, thank you so much. Bart, thank you. Until the next one.
Thank you.